Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sahabat Hidayah Channel yang dirahmati Allah, ini adalah lanjutan ceramah dari Syekh Imran Hussein yang berjudul Implikasi Islam bagi Umat Manusia atas kembalinya Nabi Isa alaihi salam. Dalam video kali ini, Syekh Imran Hussein akan memberikan dua lagi bukti dari Al-Quran serta alasan mengapa banyak ulama Islam terkemuka menolak kepercayaan akan kembalinya Nabi Isa alaihi salam di akhir zaman. Penasaran seperti apa penjelasan beliau tentang topik tersebut? Tanpa berlama-lama lagi, mari kita simak videonya dengan seksama dan semoga bermanfaat bagi kita semua.
Bismillah awwaluhu wa akhiruh. We have given so far three proofs from the Quran demonstrating the return of the Messiah, Jesus the son of Maryam. Allah's blessing be upon them both. One last comment concerning the event of the crucifixion. For some curious reason, there are so many who have been convinced by this argument, which is false, that if you put someone on the cross, whether he dies on the cross or he does not die, according to them, that is crucifixion. And if Allah says they did not crucify him, then for them the implication is that he was never put on the cross. That's bogus. Crucifixion for the Israelite people, in order for it to confirm from the Torah that he could not have been the Messiah. Crucifixion means that he must die by hanging, and crucifixion is a form of hanging. So that is a bogus objection. What the Quran has informed us is that Allah made it appear unto them that he was crucified when in fact he was not. And the world had to wait for 600 years to learn what happened. No one knew what happened until the Quran was revealed. And that is that Allah took his soul. And so they were convinced that he was dead. But then Allah returned the soul when no one could see. According to their sources, not ours, their sources are that they put the body in a cave and sealed the cave, and there was a Roman guard outside. We don't know whether this took place or not, but this is their source. For us, Allah returned the soul when no one else could see. And then Allah raised him unto himself. This is the explanation. And on judgment day, those who say that someone else was chosen and Allah caused his appearance to change and to take on the appearance of Jesus, and that innocent man, innocent because he never claimed to be the Messiah, was then crucified, they will have to answer on Judgment Day for attributing an act of injustice to Allah, and they will be in a sorry state on Judgment Day. That's my gentle warning for them. We turn now to the fourth proof from the Quran. And I hope you're taking notes. Tomorrow, I will not be here in this world anymore. And you have to teach the subject to others. I have been traveling now for more than 5 months. at the age of more than 80, by 81 by the sun, but 83 by the moon. People younger than me can't handle this, and I've been doing it. So you should utilize this opportunity and take what I'm teaching you and learn it and explain it to others. But before we commence the second session, I omitted at the beginning to recognize in the gathering someone who was a student at the Alimi Institute of Islamic Studies, as I was a student, but he came after me. But having graduated, he continued to remain on the staff of the Institute teaching for several years. Maulana Musaddiq, who is sitting in the gathering here. And he's now in Botswana. I hope to visit Botswana next year, inshallah. So we welcome Maulana Musaddiq to the gathering today. And we are honored to have someone who is a student of the Alimi Institute and also a teacher. And so now we turn to the fourth proof from the Quran of the return of the Messiah. But before we explain this, we have to make a distinction between two Arabic words. In Surah Az-Zumar, Allah says, Allah yatawaffa al-anfusa hina mawtiha. That Allah takes the soul hina, at the time of death. Allah takes the soul. فَيُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى وَالَّتِي لَمْ تَمُدْ فِي مَنَامِهَا. And Allah, most certainly they do not die. Most certainly, Allah takes the soul when they are sleeping. فَيُمْسِكُ الَّتِي قَضَى عَلَيْهَا الْمَوْتِ. So when they are sleeping, Allah takes the soul. And then, for those for whom maut is written, He keeps the soul. وَيُرْسِلُ الْأُخْرَى إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ مُسَمَّى. And for those for whom maut or death is not written, He returns the soul. So hina mautiha means at the time of death, hina. But qabla al-maut is not the time of death. Qabla means before. Qabla al-maut means before you die. So now that we understand this distinction between hina and qabla, let's turn to this verse in Surah An-Nisa, which comes immediately after the verse of crucifixion. Allah is so angry at this effort to crucify His Nabi. And then the boasting and the sarcasm that followed, that this verse of the Quran now demonstrates the extent of His anger with those who are now referred to no longer as Banu Israel. Allah now refers to them as Al-Yahud, the Jews. But those who are weeping because they believe that He was the Messiah, Allah refers to them as An-Nasara, or the Christians. And these two communities who were formerly Banu Israel are now referred to as Ahlul Kitab. I hope that's understood. The Quran no longer uses the term Banu Israel or the Israelite people, because Banu Israel is now divided into two permanently. One side, فَآمَنَتْ طَائِفَةٌ مِّن بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ. One side believed in Him as the Messiah. And they now call the Nasara or Christians. وَكَفَرَتْ طَائِفَةٌ. And another side rejected Him as the Messiah, and they are now called Al-Yahud. And these two are now referred to in the Quran as Ahlul Kitab. You have to teach this subject tomorrow. Make sure you can teach it. And now Allah speaks in the next ayah, in Surah An-Nisa. And this is what He says. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم وإن من أهل الكتاب إلا ليؤمنن به قبل موته ويوم القيامة يكون عليهم شهيدا. That not a single one of them will escape. But they would have to believe in him. Not one of the Ahlul Kitab who had rejected him and who had celebrated his crucifixion and who were boasting, not a single one of them will escape. But they will have to believe in him as the Messiah before his death. And on judgment day, he will give evidence against them. And hence, they'll go into the hellfire, even though they've accepted him as the Messiah. This is an event which is occurring now for the second time in history. That at the time when a people are about to die, before they die, they have to accept that which they had previously rejected. And then die knowing that they're going into the hellfire despite accepting. When did this happen before? This is how you have to connect the verses of the Quran the way you connect the stars to be able to understand what Allah is teaching. When Fir'aun was dying, he was underneath the water, something happened thousands of years ago. And no one knew about it until the Quran was revealed. Similarly, no one knew what happened at the time of the crucifixion until the Quran was revealed. No one knew. And so to the extent that this Quran is the word of the one God, this is the truth now being disclosed to mankind for the first time. So be careful. Before you reject the Quran as the word of the one God, because if you reject the Quran as the word of the one God, and it is indeed the word of the one God, then you're going to pay a terrible price for that. So Pharaoh had rejected Moses, as the prophet, and rejected the Torah, and the truth which has come in the Torah about one God. And Pharaoh had declared of himself, as of course the American government now declares, and the British government now declares, Ana Rabbukumul A'la. I am the Lord God Most High. That's what Washington says. That's what London is saying. That's what all the governments are saying today. The Lord God can tell you, the prophet can tell you, when you pray, stand shoulder to shoulder. But I am the government and I'm telling you, stand 3 feet apart. Is this what happened? Huh? So are you God? You're playing God. And if we choose to follow the government, we're no longer worshipping Allah. No, not at all. And so, when Pharaoh rejected Moses, Musa, rejected the Torah, and declared, Ana Rabbukum al-A'la, I am the Lord Most High. And he was persecuting and oppressing the Israelite people as Modi is oppressing the people of Kashmir today. Then when Allah told Musa, strike the water, and the Red Sea parted, and the Israelites were able to pass to Sinai safely. But when Pharaoh and his army attempted to cross, the waters came down and they were drowned. But when Pharaoh was dying, before he died, he realized that he was not God. And he declared, I now believe in the God of the Israelite people, but he didn't have a tape recorder down there underneath the water. So we don't have a tape recording of this declaration. But he did this before he died. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then responded. And he said, Al-An, and this is Surah to Yunus, take a note of it. Now Pharaoh, وَقَدْ عَصَيْتَ قَبْلًا, and before this you were in rejection, وَكُنْتَ مِنَ الْمُفْسِدِينَ, and you were committing fasad, corruption and oppression, destruction on earth. فَالْيَوْمَ نُنَجِّيكَ بِبَدَنِكَ, this day, O Pharaoh, I have ordained that I will preserve your physical body. Why? لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً, that you, O Pharaoh, meaning your physical body when it is discovered, your physical body when it resurfaces in history, as it did in the year 1897. لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً, that your physical body, when it is discovered, will function as a sign for a people to come after you. The body of Pharaoh was discovered in 1897 and positively identified. So what was the sign? لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً, that your physical body, when it resurfaces in history, would function as a sign for a people to come after you. What is the sign? This is not ta'wil, this is tafsir. That a people who will live the way you lived will die the way you died. This is not ta'wil or interpretation, this is tafsir. لِتَكُونَ لِمَنْ خَلْفَكَ آيَةً, that your physical body, when it is rediscovered, will function as a sign for a people to come after you, that they would live the way you lived and will die the way you died. Meaning, at the last moment, just before death, just before he died, Pharaoh had to declare his belief in that which he had rejected all his life. And then he died and went into the hellfire. And so Allah is saying, وَإِن مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ إِلَّا لَيُؤْمِنَنَّ بِهِ قَبْلَ مَوْتِهِ. Before he dies, every single one of them will have to accept him as the Messiah before he dies. Before he dies. And so the Quran is confirming that he will return. And at that time when he returns, before he experiences maut or death, every single Jew in the world, every single one of them, will have to accept him as the Messiah. And having done that, affirming the truth, they will then die and he will then give evidence against them and they'll go into the hellfire. Once upon a time, I used to be invited. I was living in the United States for about 12 years and the Jews would invite me. I was invited to give a lecture in a synagogue. I don't think they invite me anymore, but I was invited to this synagogue in New Jersey, and the hall was packed with about 200 Jews. Some of them might even listen to the lecture if they're alive today. And in that lecture, I told them, this is what is going to happen to you. Allah gave me the courage. I said, this is what is going to happen to you. When the lecture was over, they surrounded me. I'm in the middle and they're all around me. Why should we be forced to accept what we reject? I said, because the veils will be removed of your eyes on that day. And you'll be able to see now what you can. You'll be able to see at that time what you now cannot see. And you will have to accept him as the Messiah. And then you will die and you'll go to the hellfire. So I don't think I'll be invited again. Here is the fourth proof that the Messiah will return. And that when he returns and before he dies, before his death, before he experiences maut, at that time every Jew will have to accept him as the Messiah. There is no option for them. There are objections to this explanation. Muhammad Asad, may Allah have mercy on his soul, he was a great scholar, I have great respect for him. But he makes this comment. He says that the word, the pronoun, who does not refer to Jesus. It refers to the Jew. He says that every Jew, at the moment when he is dying, since the revelation of the Quran, will accept Jesus as the Messiah and then die. But since it is occurring at the moment of his death, there is no evidence. This is the extraordinary explanation of this verse of the Quran from Muhammad Asad, a man and a scholar for whom I personally have great, great respect. But he made a mountain of a mistake, because the Quran is saying, قَبْلَ مَوْتِ, that before he dies, he will affirm that Jesus is the Messiah. And you are saying, حِينَ الْمَوْتِ, at the moment of death, he will declare that he is the Messiah, and therefore no evidence of that. Muhammad Asad is wrong. Return now to the fifth proof from the Quran, and this is the one that is by far and away the most important of all. In Surah Az-Zukhruf of the Quran, Allah has sent down a verse which says plainly and clearly that Nabi Isa alayhi salam is the sign of the last hour. And that is an ayah muhkama. It simply needs tafsir. It does not need ta'wil. If he is the sign of the last hour, then the tafsir of this, the explanation is, his return is the sign of the last hour. Because there's nothing else in his life which qualifies. But the Quran was sent down on the night of Qadr, Laylatul Qadr. It was sent down from the Lawh al-Mahfuz, the preserved tablet in the heavens, to the Sama al-Dunya, to the lowest strata, the lowest Sama. It did not come down to Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam on that night. It did not come down to mankind on that night, not at all. On the night of Qadr, inna anzalnahu fi laylatil Qadr. On the night of power, the Quran came down to the Sama al-Dunya, not to Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, not to mankind. From the Sama al-Dunya, it came down to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam in two ways. The first one is called wahi. It came to the heart. And anything that came as wahi was instantly memorized. And the Prophet, Allah's blessings be upon him, would then dictate what was received as wahi. The scribes would then write it down. He would then ask them to recite what they had written. And when they recited, this is something in the world of sound, he will then confirm what they have recited to be correct. He has not seen the written document. He cannot tell whether what they have written is correct. He's not authenticating any written document because he cannot read. So the Quran, which has come from Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, authorized by him, so wahi, is a Quran in the world of sound. But when you have all of these scribes, so many of them, and all of them recording what was dictated to them, if there are any discrepancies between them, they would immediately resolve it, because they are the companions of the Prophet. So they'll check to see, make sure that what they're writing, all of them are writing the same thing. So we have some confidence that the written text of the Quran has a measure of authenticity in it. But the authorized text from the Prophet himself is in the world of sound. But then there's something called tashkir that helps you to recite the Quran, and that is the Fatha, the Kesra, the Dhamma, the Sukun, the Shadda, and so on. Vowel sounds. And the copies of the Quran which were written by the scribes had no tashkeel in them, none. And the earliest copies of the Quran still remaining in the world today do not have tashkeel in them. No fatha, no kesra, no dhamma. Don't believe me? Go check it out. The fatha and the kesra and the dhamma, the tashkeel, were introduced sometime later. And they were done to help those who were not Arabs to be able to recite the Quran, because the Arabs didn't need the tashkeel. If you pick up an Arabic newspaper, you're not going to find any tashkeel in it. The Arabs don't need it. No. So now, the tashkeel were introduced sometime later by human beings who put them in to help those of us who are not Arabs. And so the tashkeel did not come down as wahi, did not come down with Jibreel alayhi salam. If anyone has such a view, please correct it, because you're making a mistake. I hope I've explained that. So if we find today there's something which is a mistake in the tashkeel, can that be a mistake in the Quran? Is there anyone who has such a poverty of intelligence to say that a mistake in the tashkeel would imply a mistake in the Quran? Is there anyone with such poverty of intelligence? The tashkeel never came down as wahi. The tashkeel were not there in the Quran, in the early copies of the Quran. The tashkeel was introduced later on by human beings. And therefore, this is not something protected by Allah. It is the Quran which is protected by Allah, not the humanly introduced tashkeel. Is there anyone who differs with me? Is there anyone who differs with me? Yes? Okay, so now then, this is what the verse says. The verse in Surah Zukhruf, it's a passage, is speaking about Banu Israel, and is speaking about the Messiah, Nabi Isa alayhi salam. That is the context. And now the pronoun refers to Jesus, Nabi Isa alayhi salam. And Allah says, وَإِنَّهُ بَعْدَ أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَإِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِلسَّاعَةِ. And surely he is the sign of the last hour, meaning surely he, Nabi Isa alayhi salam, is a sign of the last hour. This is an ayah muhkamah. When we explain this, that the sign of the last hour, that he is the sign of the last hour, means that he will return, and it is his return which becomes the sign of the last hour, exactly as Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has declared. Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam has declared that he will return. The most powerful voice in history to have prophesied that Nabi Isa alayhi salam will return is the voice of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. So, innahu la'alamun lissa'a, surely he is the sign of the last hour, is very easy to understand because of the prophecy of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, that it is his return which is function as a sign, as they say in French, par excellence, of the last hour. And this is the way that the companion of the Prophet Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, who was one of the foremost companions in the study and the explanation of the Quran, Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, he recited the verse this way, وَإِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِسَّاعَةٍ. Now then, the Quran is now declaring quite plainly and clearly that Jesus will return, because he is a sign of the last hour. How then can we explain? How then can we explain that so many eminent scholars have rejected his belief in his return? That Sheikh al-Azhar gives a fatwa that he's dead, he's not coming back. That Muhammad Asad declares he's dead, he's not coming back. That my own teacher, blessed memory, says only, it is only a prophecy of Nabi Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam that he is coming back, not the Quran. How do we explain this? The explanation is that you will not find a single copy of the Quran today which says, وَإِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِسَّاعَةٍ. None. Every single copy of the Quran that is recorded, written today, is saying something else because of a different tashkil. Now that sounds to me very mysterious. And that sounds to me very suspicious. I'm using two very important words here. How come? For intelligent people like my gathering here tonight, excuse me, not those who say Imran Hussein is a kafir, I'm talking about intelligent people. How come when Abdullah ibn Abbas recites it as وَإِنَّهُ لَعَلَمٌ لِسَّاعَةٍ, he is the sign of the last hour, and our Prophet has prophesied that he will return, and therefore this is the sign, this is tafsir, that it is the return of Nabi Isa alayhi salam which is the sign of the last hour. How do you explain that the entire world has abandoned Abdullah ibn Abbas? The entire world! Every single copy of the Quran you can find today is saying something else. It is saying, because of a different tashkil, it is saying, وَإِنَّهُ لَعِلْمٌ لِسَّاعَةٍ, which also is an ayah muhkamah. And surely he is the knowledge of the hour. So my first question is, how do we explain the abandonment of Abdullah ibn Abbas by every single copy of the Quran today? Give me an answer for that. Number two, if we accept this tashkil, وَإِنَّهُ لَعِلْمٌ لِسَّاعَةٍ, then plainly and clearly this is an ayah muhkama, that he is the knowledge of the hour. It's a plain and straightforward statement that he is the knowledge of the hour. And so it would be an exercise in intellectual acrobatics to take an ayah muhkama and transform it into an ayah mutashabiha. But the problem is, for every single copy of the text of the Quran today in written form, which says, وَإِنَّهُ لَعِلْمٌ لِلسَّاعَةِ, surely he, namely Nabi Isa alayhi salam, surely he is the ilm of the hour. And ilm is knowledge. Anyone differs with me? Ilm means knowledge. Anyone differs with me? So surely he, Jesus, he is the knowledge of the hour. But Allah says that this Quran is free from contradiction. لَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدَ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. Which surah is this? Anybody? Hasbada? Surah An-Nisa. And if this Quran had come from any source that other than from Allah, they would have found in it many contradictions, many discrepancies. So this Quran is free from contradiction. Free from contradiction. But the Quran says that the knowledge of the last hour is only with Allah. And the Bible, the Gospel says, I think it's Matthew, up to this day it says, the Bible says, the knowledge of the last hour is only with the Father, not with the Son. That's what the Gospel says to this day. And the Quran says the same thing, that the knowledge of the last hour is with Allah, not with Nabi Isa, not with Nabi Muhammad, not with anybody else, only with Allah, only with Allah, only with Allah. And so there is a contradiction. When you recite the Quran this way, that he is the knowledge of the hour. If you don't believe me, if you're not convinced, then wait on Judgment Day. If you choose not to use your own capacity to think and recognize that there is a contradiction here, then wait for Judgment Day. People with elementary thinking are able to understand that he cannot be the knowledge of the last hour when the knowledge of the last hour is only with Allah. Now then, Muhammad Asad and others as well, I believe, try to get out of this. First of all, before we turn to that, those who say, no, it is actually an ayah mutashabiha, that when Allah said he is the knowledge of the hour, what Allah meant by that is that he is the sign of the hour, the last hour. You'll find that in Maulana Maujudi, rahimahullah, his tafsir of the Quran. You find it in nearly every tafsir. So they have taken an ayah muhkama and interpreted it to make it an ayah mutashabiha, which is inadmissible. And this is an ayah muhkama, surely innahu la'alamun lisa'. This is an ayah muhkama. And now you made this in an ayah mutashabiha. And when you make an ayah mutashabiha, only Allah can confirm that you are correct. Only Allah can confirm that you are correct. So you can't, if you say, when Allah said, he is the knowledge of the hour. What Allah meant is he is a sign of the hour, but Allah knows best. That's all you have to say. But Allah knows best. But on this side, you have an ayah muhkamah. Surely he is the sign of the last hour, Adamun Nisa. So this is superior to this. An ayah muhkamah is Ummul Kitab. An ayah mutashabihah is not Ummul Kitab. I hope this is not too difficult for you to understand. And now then we turn to the curious tafsir, which declares that when Allah says, when the tashkir says, wa innahu la ilmul lisaa, the tashkir is not referring to Nabi Isa alayhi salam. The pronoun is not referring to Nabi Isa alayhi salam. The pronoun is referring to the Quran. That the Quran is the knowledge of the last hour. This is Muhammad Asad. Number one, the context of the passage is Nabi Isa alayhi salam, not the Quran. So you're wrong. Number two, Allah says that the knowledge of the last hour is only with him. He doesn't say it's in the Quran. He says the knowledge of the last hour is only with him. So the Quran cannot be the knowledge of the last hour. So Muhammad Asad is wrong in his tafsir of the Quran. And now we can explain why is it that so many eminent scholars of the Quran have declared that he is dead and he's not returning. This is the main reason of all, because they have been misled by this wrong tashkil. They have been misled to recite the Quran in a manner different from that of Abdullah ibn Abbas, the most eminent companion of the Prophet والسلام, in the knowledge of the Quran. They have been misled to believe that the Quran is saying that he is the knowledge of the hour, when in fact the Quran is saying he is a sign of the hour. Here is the explanation for this momentous catastrophe in Islamic scholarship. We can only pray that those who are still alive today, and there are eminent scholars who are still alive today, I don't want to mention their names. There are eminent scholars who are alive today who still insist that Jesus is dead and is not returning. I can only pray that I'm planting the seeds here in Birmingham, planting the seeds. And tomorrow there'll be those who will emerge as scholars, brilliant scholars, who'll be able to teach the Quran on this subject and convincingly demonstrate that the Quran has established clearly that the Messiah will one day return. We have now completed the five proofs from the Quran which establish the return of the Messiah. Have I forgotten anything? No, okay.
Semoga apa yang telah disampaikan oleh Syekh Imran Hussein hari ini membuka hati dan pikiran kita semua mengenai signifikasi kembalinya Nabi Isa alaihi salam dalam perspektif Islam. Jika Anda suka dengan video ini, jangan lupa untuk menekan tombol like dan subscribe. Dan pastikan Anda juga mengaktifkan notifikasi agar tidak ketinggalan ceramah lainnya dari Syekh Imran Hussein. Terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.